Hello everyone, welcome to our UN College digital class. So I hope you people have gone through our previous two video lecture where we have discussed our case studies. Our first case study on an embedded system, that is the insulin pump control system, and in the last video lecture we have discussed the second case study on an information system. And in this particular video we are going to discuss our third and last case studies on a data collection system, that is a wilderness weather information system. So let us see why we are using this weather information system and what are the purpose for such system and how the weather collection system works. So here we are going to discuss on wilderness weather information system, which is a data collection system. The name is weather information system. So the name itself indicates that this system or this particular system is going to help us to generate the weather report, that how we can predict the weather information, that what will be the weather for the next month, for the next 15 days or for the next week. Okay, so this information system will help us to generate the weather report. So whenever we want to generate any weather report, then we have to collect some weather data. That means a huge amount of weather data should be collected, and this should be analyzed and processed, and then only we can say what will be the weather for next 5 days for a particular area. That means the most important thing is we need those weather data or weather related data from a particular location. After that we can say what will be the weather for that particular location for next 5 days or next month. Okay, so this particular weather information system, or we can call it as a wilderness weather information system, will help us to generate the weather data. Like suppose take an example, if I am talking about a particular state, like in Odisha, automatically there will be 30 districts, and under each district there will be so many subdivisions. Okay, so the weather related data like your pressure, temperature, rainfall, wind speed, your wind direction, so all those weather related data are to be collected from each subdivision. Then from there those data should be get transmitted to your district level, and all the district level weather informations or weather related data will be transferred to a centralized processing unit. Like in our Odisha, there is a office in Bhubaneswar which is the centralized data processing unit for the weather forecasting. Okay, so all district levels weather information should be get transmitted to the Bhubaneswar's office, and then only at the weather station which is at Bhubaneswar, they will analyze those data, they will process those data, then they will forecast what will be the weather for our state Odisha or for each district of Odisha. Okay, like similarly, if we take a country into our consideration, like in India, there are so many places which are the remote areas, or we can say those areas are a nature of wilderness area. Wilderness in the sense, that means those areas are the remote area, that means in that area it is not possible for us to collect data from that remote area. That means we cannot go manually to those area every day, and we cannot collect all those weather related data. Then after collecting those data, they will be get processed, but it is impossible to collect those data from those remote areas. So what about the collection of data, weather related data from the remote areas? So there we need a software based applications, which is the weather information system. Then those weather information system or those software based system will get installed into that remote areas. Then by the software we are collecting all those weather related data every day, and after that those data will be sent to a central data processing unit, and then we will predict what will be the weather for the next week or next month. Okay, so let us see what is the actual weather information system, or we can call it as a wilderness weather information system, because we people are using this weather information system software in at the remote areas, at the wilderness areas. So we can call it as a wilderness weather information system. So there are several hundred weather stations that need to be installed in a large areas of a wilderness area. Then the government of each country decided that the 100 or weather stations will be installed into that remote areas, so that the weather related data would be collected from those remote areas. Okay, because when we are predict that what will be the weather, then the data collection from each part, each and every part of the country is necessary. We should collect the weather related data from each part, from the urban areas and also from the remote areas. So the weather information system is there, which will be installed into that remote areas or wilderness areas. Then that system will collect the weather related data and send us. That means they will send those weather related data to the data processing unit, and then after we will analyze and process and we will predict what will be the weather. So the second thing is, what exactly the weather station is? What do you mean by a weather station? What we are going to install in that remote areas? Okay, so there are so many instruments are used in that weather station. So variety of instruments are there. Then when we combine those instruments into one unit, then it will call as a weather station. And these instruments are responsible for collecting the weather data, like your temperature, your pressure, sunshine, rainfall, wind speed and wind directions. That means those instruments are also available there for 24/7 to collect these weather related data, like every day the instruments are going to use. So this is very much essential that those instruments are continuously measuring the weather data. That's why the system is called as the data collection system. So here the collection data should be a continuous process at a regular interval of time, because whenever we want to predict something, then we need a huge amount of data to process and analyze. Then only the system will let you know what will be the weather for the next 1 week or for the next month. So that's why there are some instruments into that weather station should be available 24/7. And those instruments are controlled by a software. That software is responsible for controlling all the instruments and monitoring that all the instruments are working properly or not. So there should be a software. So this is also a combination of software and hardware. The hardware are the instruments, those are responsible for collecting the weather related data, and there should be a software that will control all those instruments that are inside those weather stations. Next, look into the weather station's environment. How the weather station environment looks like? Okay, so this is the diagram for weather station environment. Here we have three major stations. First one is your weather station. Second one is your data management and archiving. Third one is your station maintenance. Okay, so first see, here I am using a symbol. This is a system. And also there is a system. This symbol is known as package symbol. That means, just try to recall, when we are talking about the insulin pump control system, there we are using a activity model. So activity model is what? Those are the system models. So before designing a system in a real time, we should design that system by using some system model. So there are some activity model, there are some UML diagram, there are some package diagram also. So here I am using that package diagram to represent the weather station environment. So this package diagram, that means I mentioned here system. That means this is the whole system, and the system is consisting of three subsystems. One is your weather station, which is the major part of the weather station's environment, which we have discussed earlier, that what are the work of that weather station. Then there is another subsystem, that is data management and archiving, and third is the station maintenance subsystem. Okay, so all these subsystems, when combined together, then we can call it as a wilderness weather information system. Okay, so individually they are also some systems, or we can call it as a system of system. So when we were talking about the application software types, there there was one type, that is system of system. That means combination of two or more system will be called as a system of system. So here we are having three subsystem, then combining those three subsystem into one system, we can call it as a system of system. Basically, we refer the weather information system as a data collection system, because this system is responsible for collecting weather related data and generating appropriate output, that is the weather report. So we can call it as a data collection system, but if you want to call it as a system of system, then it will also be okay. So let us see what are the actually work of those three subsystems. The first one is weather station system. Okay, so the weather station system is responsible for collecting weather related data and carrying out some initial data processing and transmitting it to the data management system. That means weather information system is the system which is to be installed in that remote area. That means those areas where we cannot go personally and we cannot collect those data personally. So in that areas we have to install the weather information system, then the weather information system will collect the weather related data like your temperature, pressure, rainfall and all, and all those data will be get some initial processing, and then after those data will send to a data management system. So let's see what is the actual work of the data management and archiving system. Okay, so this system collects the data from all of the wilderness weather stations and carries out data processing and analysis and archives those data. So that means there are some wilderness weather information systems, those are the software based systems which are get installed into the remote areas, and there should be a centralized data management unit. Okay, like in Bhubaneswar we have our weather station, that is the centralized data management system. So all those wilderness weather stations data will be transferred to the main hub, that is the centralized data management system, and then after receiving all those district level data at the centralized data management system, those data will be processed, those data will be analyzed, then it will predict what will be the weather for the next week or next month. After generating the report, all those data need to be stored. That means they should be kept permanently, because suppose take an example, in our news channel or whatever, they are forecasting that what will be the rainfall for this year in our Odisha. So how they will predict this? Okay, because they have data of rainfall for the previous 3 to 4 years, then they will analyze all those data which they have stored in their database from the last 3 to 4 years, then they will process those data, then they will predict what will be the rainfall for this year in Odisha. Okay, so those data should be kept permanently, that means they should be archiving in a permanent database store. Okay, then the next is the station maintenance system. The system can communicate by satellite with all wilderness weather stations to monitor the health of this system and provide reports of problems. That means when the wilderness weather stations are collecting weather data and transmitting the data to the centralized data hub, then how it is possible? It is possible because of the satellites over there. The satellites are responsible for collecting those weather informations and sending those weather data to the centralized data processing system. So there should be a station maintenance system that will maintain all those systems, all those wilderness weather information system. Like there must be some power supply, because they are the remote areas, they are the wilderness areas, we cannot go personally to those areas. So there are some weather information system, and inside the weather information system there are some instruments. Those instruments are responsible for collecting the weather related data, and there should be a software which is responsible for controlling those instruments. Okay, so for proper working of these instruments and software there should be a power supply. Okay, so these system maintenance so these station maintenance system should be there to check whether all the instruments, the that software, the satellite, the power supply, all are available 24/7 and all are working properly or not. So that should be a station maintenance system. So next come to additional software functionality. That means when we are using the weather information system, then what we are expecting from that weather information system. The first one is it should monitor the instruments, the power supply and the communication hardware and report faults to the management system. Okay. So this particular point says that the system should monitor whether all the instruments and the software is working properly or not. If there are some miscommunication between the satellite and the weather information system, then the system should be capable to report that fault immediately to the data management system. So the particular point says that the system should monitor all the instruments, the software, and even if the communication header that are used to communicate the weather information system to the data management system, that means those satellites, and if there are any fault or there will any error arises in that software or in the instrument or something goes wrong with the satellite, then the fault report should be reported immediately to the data management system. The next, it says that it should manage the system power and ensuring that the batteries are charged whenever the environment condition permit. Okay. So as I said, there should be some power supply, that means there should be some batteries that will be get charged whenever the environment permits. Suppose there may be a high wind flow, then what will happen? The generators or the batteries that are installed in that weather station, they will may be damaged. Okay. So whenever the environment permits, so whenever the wind flow is normal, then the batteries or the generators will be charged automatically from the solar energy. And the last one is, it should support dynamic reconfiguration where parts of the software are replaced with new versions and where backup instruments are switched into the system in the event of system failure. So that means we are installing those weather information system into the remote areas. So we have to keep remember that those are the remote areas where we cannot go personally. So if any software failure occurs, then the system should be capable of downloading the new version of the software and installing the new version of the software into that system. Like in our mobile phone, there are monthly update of our operating systems. So, suppose I am using Android 1, then there are monthly updates. So my mobile is capable of downloading and installing those update versions or those new versions of Android. So like that, the weather information system should be capable of installing the new versions of softwares into the weather information system. So these are the additional software functionalities we expect from the weather information system. So this is our end of the chapter 1. So before finishing the chapter 1, let us discuss some frequently asked questions about software engineering. The first is, what is software? So as we know, software is not just like a program. Okay. The software means it is a combination of program and documentation. So I hope you people have gone through our first video where we discussed what is software in very brief manner. I'm just taking some minute to remind you what is software actually. So software is a collection of programs, a set of programs and some documentation. Like whenever we want to download a software, we are downloading that software, and along with the software, that means the executable file, along with the .exe file, those executable files, we are also downloading some documents like your copyrights, your troubleshoots, your help, and how to use that software. So those documents along with the executable file will be called as a software. So basically we say that the software is a collection of programs and the documentation. So when we are talking about the your insulin pump control system or the weather information system. There are activity models, your PACIS model, your UML diagram. So all those are the documentations. Those documents are help us to write the code for a software. So combining the programs with the documentation, what we get is a software. The next is, what is software engineering? So engineering means, engineering is the technical approach to develop some product. Okay. So software engineering means the technique, there should be some technical approach, there should be some tools, there should be some guidelines, there should be some methodologies. By using those tools, those guidelines and those methodologies, and by following some process, some set of process, what we get a product, that is a software product, or we can call it as a software application, or we can call it as a application itself. So after following those processes and after following those tools, guidelines and methodologies, we find a good software product. So that is the software engineering. The process is called as a software engineering. So whenever we are considering with software engineering, we should remember that we are the people who are going to develop a software. That means we should behave in a professional manner. We should not adopt the ad hocness approach. The ad hocness approach means we should not think that the software development is nothing. There may be some setup customer, they want to design a software, then we will go and talk with them what actually their requirement, then we will start developing the software. But actually that is the ad hocness approach. We cannot develop a software product based on that ad hocness approach. We have to go by some phases, like we should go for the software specification phase, then we will go for the design, and in that design we should think about the logic of the problem. Then after then we will design some flow chart, there should be some algorithm, and then after we will go for the coding. And after the coding, there must be a testing phase that will test your software from different aspect. Then after that we will go for the maintenance phase. That means maintenance phase is very much important. That will take the 70% of time of the software development. That will start when we deliver the product to the user, then will the maintenance phase will start. So the next is, what are the attributes of a good software? Okay. So if you remember, we have four good attributes of a good software. Those attributes are very essential for a good software. So while developing a software, we should remember that whatever the product we are going to develop, that must be a quality product that should meet a professional level. Okay. So what are those essential attributes of a good software? The first one is your maintainability. Second one is your dependability and security. Third one is your efficiency. And fourth one is your acceptability. The maintainability says that the software should be maintained regularly. That means the software should be flexible. Whatever product or whatever the application we are going to develop, that application should be flexible, because whenever any fault or any arises in future, then we can fix those errors and those faults quickly and very easily. So that is the maintainability. The next come dependability and security. So inside the dependability and security, we have four more attributes. Those are the availability, reliability, security and safety. So what actually dependability and security says, that means the software should be available 24/7. The software should be reliable, and the software should respond us in a responsive manner. That means in a quick manner, and the software should be safe to use, and the software should give us a good security. Then third is the efficiency. That means the software should be capable of efficiently use whatever the resources, whatever the memory which are available with that software development. Next, the fourth one is acceptability, which is a very essential attributes of a good software. That means the user should accept that product. So whomever we are going to develop that software product, the user should accept that product after delivering the product to that user. So these are the good attributes or essential attributes of a good software. Then the last question is, what are the difference between software engineering and computer science? So in case of computer science, we are dealing with the theoretical approaches. Like we all are learning different languages like C, C++, your Java, Python, whatever. So all these languages we are learning are in theoretical approach. We just practice those programming language in our lab, but we are not developing any software by using those languages, your C, C++ or whatever. Okay. So the computer science actually deals with the theoretical approach, and but the software engineering deals with the practical approach. That means when there should be some process and there should be some methodologies, some techniques, some tools, then by using those process, those methodologies, those techniques, those tools, when we are developing a software product, a good software product, then that will be called as a software engineering. So this is all about the frequently asked questions. Here we are come up with the end of our chapter 1. In the next video, we will go for the chapter 2, that is the software process. Thank you.